Welcome and thank you everyone for attending the Trail Talks tonight. I'm Ahmad Mirza, I'm a librarian here with the Santa Barbara Public Library. Before we begin, I wanted to give a big, big thank you and shout out to our library partner, James Wapetich, for assisting and helping and giving time, his time for bringing this program and working with us together. So big shout out and thank you to James for help coordinating these events. And if anyone's interested in following James's adventures, you can check his blog, www.songsofthewilderness.com. And once again, that's James's blog. You can sign up for his newsletter there and just see everything that he's working on. And that's www.songsofthewilderness.com. If you want to register for the next Trail Talks, it's on the library calendar. Now actually, and that's going to be on Thursday, February 17th. And that one is titled Los Padres Forest Association Backcountry Trails Update. And I'm sorry if I mispronounced the name here, but that's with Brian, and I think it's Canant. We'll be hosting that talk. So that we are very excited for. It's on the library's calendar. You can register there. And again, that's going to be Thursday, February 17th, same time as we usually have it. Just a different Zoom link that will be shared. Before I introduce our speaker this evening, I wanted to also say anyone who has any questions during the presentations to please put them in the chat. If we have time at the end of the presentation, we'll try to get to your questions. Once again, this presentation is recorded and we plan to put it on the library's YouTube page. For those of you who have registered through the library's website, we hope to, once it's up on the YouTube page, we'll send a link follow up to all those registered so that you could have access. But if you check it, you know, in a few days, it should be there on the YouTube page, on Santa Barbara Public Library's YouTube page. Now, get all that out of the way. We want to introduce our speaker this evening. And join us for this evening's great evening for discussion with Lanny Coffer. Lanny has been leading herb walks in Ventura and Santa Barbara counties since 1976, educating scores of locals and visitors on the flora of the area. As an herbal educator, Lanny also leads workshops and presentations throughout the Ojai, Ventura, Santa Barbara area on edible and medicinal uses of California plants. Lanny, who's been very busy, also recently published a book, as you can see here, Medicinal Herbs of California, A Field Guide to Common Healing Plants. And that's Falcon Guides 2021 there. And we hope that he will share some of the process of putting the book together and his connections to the Santa Barbara region. Lanny actively shares his works online through his website, Herb Talks, and that's Herb Walks, herbwalks.com. Also shares his work through his newsletter and social media. And with that, I want to pass the floor to you, Lanny. I really appreciate your time today. And we are very excited for this presentation. Already 85 people in attendance. So,
well, thank you, Ahmad. It's a pleasure to be here. And I also want to send a shout out to James, backpacking and hiking expert extraordinaire, for helping to put this together and inviting me to be here. So, I'll be sharing a few plants featured in my book. I mean, I can't help talking about that because it just came out and it's my first book. Plants that you're likely to find on local trails. And I'm also going to discuss three plants that I think are worthy of investigation as possible treatments for COVID-19. And since it's a library talk, and I assume I'm speaking to a group of bibliophiles, at least people who know what that word means, I thought you might be interested in me diving into the writing process a little. So I'll be talking about that too. And as Ahmad mentioned, I'm going to reference some of the personal Santa Barbara connections to the book. So let's get started. Almost all the knowledge we have today about edible and medicinal plants of North America, we got from Native Americans. So it's fitting that my own introduction to medicinal plants happened at the Jemez Pueblo in New Mexico while traveling from my home at that time in Santa Barbara in 1967. While visiting the Pueblo for several days by invitation, I came down with a cold, and an older man brought me a bag of what he called cedar tea and instructed me on how to use it. I know today that the tea he brought me was either this one, Western Red Cedar Leaf, or this one, Incense Cedar Leaf. The leaves of both of these species are known to most native people as flat cedar. In addition to tea, they are often used as smudging herbs, burned for ceremonial purification. Both species are also found in California and are included in my book. Juniper species are used interchangeably for smudging and called round cedar due to the shape of the leaves. All three of these conifers are members of the cypress family and bear scaled leaves rather than the needles associated with the pine family of conifers. After drinking the cedar tea and inhaling the steam, my cold miraculously went away and a lifelong curiosity was born. As soon as I returned to Santa Barbara, I searched libraries and bookstores for books on medicinal herbs and found this one, Back to Eden by Jethro Kloss. I actually think I found it in the Santa Barbara Library, but I can't be sure at this point, and it's not in the catalog now. Back to Eden really launched the alternative medicine movement of the 1960s. Jethro Kloss was an herbalist in the tradition of Samuel Thompson, the first great American herbalist, whose system of botanical medicine became popular in the US starting in the 1830s as an alternative to medical practices such as bloodletting that were the standard among licensed physicians of the time. The problem for me was that Back to Eden is Eastern US based and it includes virtually no plants found in California. So I was thrilled when in the early 1970s, I learned that UCSB Extension was offering a field class on Chumash plant uses, co-taught by Juanita Centeno, who became my friend, Chumash teacher, and eventual collaborator when I began leading herb walks a few years later. She's pictured here as shown in a permanent display case at the Lompoc Museum, which is where she lived. Well, not in the museum, but in Lompoc. And here again on the far left of this mural. My book is dedicated to Juanita and she is referenced throughout. She also was an important modern day resource for Jan Timbrook's excellent 2007 book, Chumash Ethnobotany, published by the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History, where Jan serves as an anthropologist. Sadly, it is out of print at the moment. But the good news is it's still available for purchase in the museum's online bookstore at sbnature.org. So get it while you can. And there are two copies in the Santa Barbara Library. Before I share some plants, let me say a few words about my writing process, which began by deciding which plants to include in the book. I made a list of all the medicinal plants I knew of in California, and that list topped 200. But the publisher wanted no more than 70. So the first step was setting up a system for selecting the plants to include. I chose the plants based on these five criteria. One, is the plant common enough in California to justify small-scale sustainable collecting? Two, is a good part of the plant's range within California? Or is California on the fringes of its range? In other words, is it a better fit in a neighboring state's book on medicinal herbs? Three, is it a non-native weed so common throughout the United States that it's sufficiently covered in many other books? Four, is there sufficient evidence of indigenous medicinal use of the plant? And five, is there sufficient modern scientific validation of its Native American uses? It was important to me that my readers shared my concern for the conservation status of the plants. So I included an opening section on native plant conservation focused on the organizations that monitor it, and their names are in bold print on that slide. Then I followed through with a conservation status rankings for each plant based on these four organizations' lists as shown there. I also wrote an introductory section on sustainable collecting, which included relevant California Penal Code sections 384A and B. This is a complicated subject, and I had a hearty discussion about it with Jan Timbrook, as a matter of fact, recently. And I won't get into that whole thorny topic right now, but I'll be happy to tackle it during the Q&A. And finally, on this topic of conservation, I included cultivation tips for each plant. As much as anyone in this virtual room, I want to see these plants thriving for future generations. So it was important to me to emphasize that people can grow their own and that we can encourage our local organic farmers to start putting in beds for some of the popular medicinal plants as they come to be in demand. The publisher actually told me, well, my editor told me that they don't put information about cultivation in their field guides. They said, this is not a gardening book, it's a field guide. But I insisted that because of the conservation concerns, it was really important to me to add this section on cultivation. As for the medicinal information at the heart of the book, I included an opening section called A Brief History of Medicinal Herbs in America, which describes a series of events that occurred beginning in 1910 and led to the exclusion of herbs from the US pharmacopoeia, placing them outside the scope of practice of MDs. And equally troubling, led to the closing of medical schools that taught botanical medicine, as well as those that serve Black and female students. You could call that part collateral damage. And then in describing each herb, I presented evidence and cited studies so that my readers might reconsider plants as sources of medicinal compounds. I scoured every book in my library and added more books and dug deep into the anthropological and pharmacological literature online, and into my own personal human resources, people like Juanita, for a consilience of evidence for both the indigenous uses, what we call the empirical evidence, and the modern scientific validation of those uses, which comes from laboratory and clinical studies. So let's meet a few plants. Our virtual trail hike this evening will begin in the coastal sage scrub plant community. This is the habitat found on the coastal slopes and foothills just inland from the beaches and sand dunes that border the ocean. Coastal sage scrub rarely occurs above 3,000 feet or on the inland side of the coast range. There is actually an interior sage scrub habitat in some places, but I don't want to get too technical because we're going to get a little technical as we go along into the medicinal stuff here. Coastal sagebrush, our first plant today, is one of the indicator species of the coastal sage scrub community, along with the true sages of the genus Salvia, which we will get into next. It was one of the first plants that Juanita taught me and my fellow students, and she placed great value on it as a women's herb. Sagebrush is rich in medicinal compounds called terpenes. Terpenes are among the many natural chemical compounds found in plants. Scientists call these compounds phytochemicals, a more scientific way of saying plant chemicals. Terpenes and terpenoids are the primary constituents of the essential oils of many types of plants and flowers, including sagebrush. They are often strong smelling and serve to protect plants against bacterial and fungal diseases and herbivory, that is, being eaten by insects and animals. The subtle difference between terpenes and terpenoids is that terpenes are simple carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, hydrocarbons, whereas terpenoids contain additional functional groups attached to the CHO hydrocarbon. So these terpenes and other compounds are found in many plants, and they're mostly there, as I said, for the protection of the plant. But humans have learned how to harness the power of these medicinal compounds for our uses, and I'll be talking about them quite a bit here. Many terpenes and terpenoids have been shown to have pain-relieving properties, especially when applied topically, that is, externally. In Healing with Medicinal Plants of the West, the book written by Chumash healer Cecilia Garcia and pharmacologist James Adams, the authors write that Artemisia californica contains at least 15 monoterpenoids that are powerful pain relievers. These compounds rapidly cross the skin to affect the pain receptors in the nervous system and also have anti-inflammatory activity. So this pain-relieving property was harnessed by the Chumash and other native people by making an ointment with it using bear grease, most likely other kinds of animal fat. Dr. Adams and Cecilia Garcia found that it actually, the most effective way to draw out the medicinal compounds is to make a liniment. And there's the recipe for the liniment right there. You can find that recipe in my book, courtesy of Dr. Adams. And of course, it's also in their book, which I also highly recommend. In addition to those pain-relieving properties, I learned something else really unique and special about coastal sagebrush from Juanita. You can see there how the older leaves have turned brown, but they haven't fallen off the branch. Most dead leaves on plants tend to drop off, but on sagebrushes, they hang there for quite a long time. So Juanita showed us how to strip these dried leaves off the stem, rub them into a fine powder between our fingers. And of course, you could make a finer powder using a mortar and pestle, but it works pretty well just in your hand. And this fine powder is naturally antifungal. Diaper rash is a fungal infection. So the Chumash use this powder to swaddle their babies to prevent diaper rash because traditional Chumash, and of course the Chumash are still with us, and I hope some of you are here on this talk, but some of these uses are associated with practices from the past, like carrying a baby around all day on a cradle board, which is maybe some people are still doing that. But in any case, this was quite a novel use of this powder, which we know now today from pharmacology is antifungal. But there's just another example of native people using something, not having the university knowledge of plant chemicals and so on, but yet finding a way to use these medicinal compounds. It could also be used for athlete's foot, which is also a fungal infection. Next, we're going to look at three of the true sages. Now, sagebrush is not a true sage. True sages are of the genus Salvia of the mint family. And we have several sages. I think we have five native sages in this area. Sages love the Mediterranean climate, which is what we have. So we're rich in sage. The Latin name Salvia comes from the Latin word salvus, meaning healthy, and salveri, meaning to cure. Now, that's quite a recognition from the ancient Europeans of the value of this plant, I would say, to give the genus a name like that. And traditionally, both in this country, among native people, and in traditional herbalism of Europe, sage and its essential oil have been used to treat a wide range of illnesses. Salvia plants contain many active compounds, including monoterpenoids that I mentioned in relation to the sagebrush, as well as diterpenoids that can be antibacterial or anti-allergic. Also present are anti-inflammatory compounds, antibiotic compounds, and anti-anxiety compounds. Now, purple sage is the local sage closest in flavor to European garden sage, the sage of commerce, the one you'll find in little tins and jars at the supermarket. And our purple sage can be used as a substitute for that sage. But in addition to its culinary use, sage leaf is an incredibly useful medicinal herb. It is anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, antifungal, aids digestion, relieves cramps, reduces diarrhea, dries up phlegm, fights colds, reduces inflammation and swelling, and kills bacteria. Purple sage, as I said, is a member of the mint family, as are all the true salvias. And my book is organized by plant families, and then within that category, the different genus and species within those families. And in addition to having these uses, it's one of our most beautiful and iconic spring wildflowers, attracting several species of native butterflies and native California bees. And, you know, while European honeybees are not native, we have at least 1,500 species of native bees in California. Unfortunately, none of them make honey, but they are very effective pollinators. So we're lucky to have them. The second sage we're going to look at is black sage. Black sage is a close cousin to purple sage with a much stronger terpene profile, meaning that it smells a lot stronger, and that makes it more medicinal. The aroma is an indication of the medicinal compounds, in this case, mostly terpenes, but it also makes it less suited for culinary use, as it can be overpowering unless you're marinating venison or wild boar. But that being said, there are people who have found ways to combine it with chocolate and other different kind of strong flavored ingredients and do some really creative stuff with it. And like purple sage, it's a very common plant in our region. Black sage leaves are greener and the flowers are smaller and more of a bluish purple than the pinkish purple compared with purple sage, compared with the flowers we just saw previously. And it's loved by European honeybees. So you can see this one going in and out of the flower. A little primitive motion picture there for you, dating back to the early 1900s. And sage honey is an important California food product. This one right here comes from a local Ojai honey company, Heavenly Honey, which you can find right on Ojai Avenue in downtown Ojai. But on the medicinal side, black sage tea contains 54 monoterpenoids that can penetrate the skin and inhibit pain receptors known as transient receptor potential cation channels. And Dr. Adams and Cecilia Garcia offer this recipe in their article on Chumash treatments for arthritis, which is one of many articles you can find on the resource page on my website, hundreds of free articles and other information. And it's also in their book, and courtesy of Dr. Adams, I was able to include this recipe in my book as well. And many people have attested to the fact that this foot soak can treat chronic pain. It has to be used for 5 days in succession. There are more details about it, but I'm not going to get into all the fine points right now, just to let you know that it's there. Now, in the early summer, the bluish purple flower heads turn into seed heads. And then eventually they dry up. Getting a closer look at them. And you can see the characteristic flowering pattern of the mint family, which is whorls of flowers and then seeds around a square stem and separated by short sections of stem between the flower heads. So that's what they look like when they're ripe. And you can see what look like little pockets on the seed head. That's where the flowers were protruding. And then when they get pollinated, the little pocket then contains a seed. Here's a look at some seeds I just shook out of one of those seed heads into my hand. They're edible and very delicious and high in protein and healthy fats. By the way, chia sage is one of the other local sages that we have in this area, and most of us have heard of chia seed. Other sage seeds are also edible, although they're not quite as mucilaginous as the chia seed, which has that very special property, but they are edible and delicious. And the third sage I want to share with you is white sage. White sage is found mostly in the coastal sage scrub and chaparral plant communities, pretty much below 5,000 feet. And it's found only from Santa Barbara County to Baja California. That's its entire range in the world. It's often considered our most medicinal local sage. And even KaiserPermanente.org, not what you would call a fringe group, describes sage as an herb that directly attacks microbes. The German Commission E, established by the German government in the 1990s to study medicinal plants, reported antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral, astringent, and perspiration inhibiting properties of their local garden sage, the European sage. In 1994, they approved its use as a mouthwash or gargle for the treatment of inflammation of the mouth and throat. They also approved its internal use for indigestion and to reduce excessive perspiration. The Germans didn't go through the upheaval that we had here that I described in my introductory chapter on the brief history of medicinal herbs in America. So they still have a heartier tradition of medicinal herbs, and in that vein, the German government set up that Commission E to look at hundreds of medicinal plants. Then more recently, around that same time in 1991, a laboratory study confirmed that white sage was able to completely inhibit the growth of candida fungal infections, staphylococcus skin infections, and Klebsiella pneumonia infections. And then another 2016 study found that white sage inhibited the growth of E. coli bacteria. The major constituents in white sage are, again, monoterpenoids, including eucalyptol, camphor, pinene, carine, camphene, limonene, myrcene, and terpenoline. As I've already mentioned, monoterpenoids have shown anti-anxiety, antimicrobial, and pain-relieving activity in numerous studies. For example, eucalyptol, which was first found in eucalyptus oil, is a well-known antimicrobial and has reported to be useful for the treatment of bronchial asthma and coughs. It may also have an anti-inflammatory effect on bronchial tissues. Then white sage also contains diterpenoids, including salviol, carnosol, and rosmanol, also known as antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory, and neuroprotective, antioxidant, and being studied for their anti-cancer properties. So this is a very potentially rich medicinal plant. Now, when I mention white sage, no doubt some or most of you have heard or have practiced smudging with white sage. Smudging is the ancient practice of purifying the air and the patient by burning aromatic antibacterial herbs. Unfortunately, as a result of the increasing popularity of smudging with white sage among non-Indigenous people, white sage is now severely impacted by over-harvesting and illegal collection in areas accessible by car. It was recently added to the United Plant Savers Species at Risk list and should not be collected in the wild by those unfamiliar with the principles and practices of sustainable foraging. In fact, even though there is still plenty of white sage in the backcountry where it's not easily accessed and it's not on any endangered species lists, in light of the conservation concerns, I recommend that people not pick it at all in the wild, but grow it at home or buy it from reputable suppliers who can show that they are growing it or collecting it sustainably with a commercial harvesting permit. And it's also important to note when you look at this photo that if you're going to try smudging, it's not necessary to burn a whole wand as shown. One leaf is sufficient unless you're smudging the whole extended family. So I'd like to talk about three plants that are local plants that deserve to be studied as possible treatments for COVID-19, the novel coronavirus, by virtue of their demonstrated ability to treat common cold and annual flu viruses. First, blue elderberry, Sambucus nigra subspecies cerulea. Elderberry flowers and fruits are rich in healthful sugars, fiber, protein, including 6 essential amino acids, vitamin C, and minerals, potassium, calcium, iron, and many others. The use of elderberry flower tea and elderberry fruit syrup to treat common colds and flus are ancient practices that have been well publicized in recent years. I suspect that almost everyone in this group has heard of elderberry or sampled it. Certainly elderberry wine has been around a very long time. Wines were one of the first ways that people discovered to preserve fruits for the rest of the year. And that's a medicinal wine. And there's also a wonderful medicinal liqueur called Saint Germain that's made from the flowers. So here's how it works. A protein in elderberry flowers can bind directly to the common flu virus and neutralize a viral protein called influenza hemagglutinin that helps the virus attach to lung cells. While the coronavirus spike protein that we've seen pictures of and heard about and the influenza hemagglutinin protein are both called viral membrane fusion proteins, which help cells move across membranes, they are genetically different. So even though elderberry is effective against the influenza virus and also seems to be effective against at least one coronavirus, the common cold, we can't assume that it will be effective against the novel COVID-19 without further study. Nonetheless, because of its long history of use, it is currently being looked at for that purpose. In the meantime, though, I need to be clear that there is no evidence yet that elderberry or the other two herbs I'm going to show you are now effective treatments for COVID-19. Elderberry fruits and flowers also contain compounds with antioxidant and immune system stimulating activity. These include pigments called anthocyanins and flavonoids, other pigments that can block the influenza virus from attaching to the dendritic cells in the lungs. Those are protective cells that protect us from things like coronavirus. And by blocking the influenza virus from attaching to those dendritic cells, it allows those cells to do their job, which is to activate the immune system. So there are multiple mechanisms of action for how elderberry and some of these other plants do their work in the human body. Elderberry preparations, and I would say most herbs, are best used at the first sign of sickness. And that's probably true of all medicines. Several studies, published studies, have shown that elderberry flowers, fruits, and products like Sambucol, a cold and flu product from Israel, can affect the onset, duration, and severity of colds and flus. And my book cites those studies. In fact, my book is unique among field guides in that it has about 350 citations to all of these various studies because I wanted to be able to back up the information I was sharing and allow people the opportunity to research it themselves. Again, something that my publisher wasn't excited about, they agreed. They were very good to work with, and they agreed that it was a good idea to share those citations to the studies. And the next plant in our lineup of three here is California Everlasting. This is a native California herb, formerly of the genus Nephalium, before DNA changed the world of botany. hence the name pseudo-Nephalium, known for its anti-inflammatory and astringent activity on in treating the inflamed mucous membranes of respiratory conditions. It's an annual or biennial, meaning it lives for 1 to 2 years. And these are first year plants seen in the spring before flowering. The leaves at that time are coated with sticky aromatic oils. And here, the plants are starting to blossom in early summer, giving off their characteristic aroma reminiscent of maple syrup, oranges, butterscotch, curry, or some combination of those pleasant scents. And it's a fire follower. So if you've probably smelled it on the trails in the last few years since the 2017 fire. The flowers are the medicinal parts, and this early stage of opening shown here is when they are harvested. Although the phytochemistry of California everlasting flowers has not been studied, many other pseudo-Nephalium and Nephalium species have been researched and shown to contain anti-inflammatory flavonoids. Several of these flavonoids are known as neuraminidase inhibitors, which means they can block viral neuraminidase, which is an enzyme that viruses use to invade healthy cells. So another different mechanism of action for a plant. The flowers also contain anthocyanins, the flavonoid compounds, pigments already mentioned in elderberry that can stimulate the immune system. And here we see the dried everlasting flowers, which are commonly seen in dry flower arrangements where they're known as straw flowers. In addition to the flavonoids, the scented species like California everlasting have aromatic oils in the leaves and flowers composed of mono and diterpenes with, again, antimicrobial and pain-relieving properties. Some species of Nephalium have inhibited Streptococcus and Staphylococcus bacteria in the laboratory. Biological studies have demonstrated antioxidant, antibacterial, antifungal, expectorant, and anti-inflammatory and other activities of Nephalium species. Again, we can only presume that those properties are also found in our local pseudo-Nephalium, but it's going to take further study. Again, that's been a challenge, which I explain in my chapter on the brief history of medicinal herbs in America. So to decrease the duration of colds and flus, Chumash healer Cecilia Garcia prepares a hot tea of the flowers by adding about a teaspoon of the flowers to a mug of water. This is brought just to boiling, turned off, and steeped for 10 minutes. Then the tea is drunk for 4 nights in a row at the first sign of sickness. And the third plant in this trio of possible anti-COVID herbs is Yerba Santa. Yerba Santa was given its common name by the Spanish settlers, I almost said invaders, but early settlers of California. And Yerba Santa in Spanish means holy herb. That was unusual for them to give a plant such a valuable name, given that they typically didn't find much to be worth sharing from the native populations in America. The Chumash and other California tribes have been known to use this plant for lung problems, including asthma, tuberculosis, and pneumonia. Bacterial pneumonia was present even before the Europeans arrived and was probably a constant problem, especially for children. Plants of this genus, Ariadictian, and there are several species in California, but this is the most common around Santa Barbara. Plants of this genus have many flavonoids in them, including Ariadictiol and Homo-Ariadictiol. California Yerba Santa, one of the other species, was formerly listed in the U.S. Pharmacopoeia and the National Formulary for use in bronchitis, but was removed in 1960 when laws required that efficacy had to be demonstrated. No company was interested in paying to conduct the clinical trials to prove the plant was effective. And unfortunately, I have to make that same statement about many of the plants in the book, that further study is needed. And while there is laboratory evidence now of the chemistry of the plants, no one has ponied up to do the clinical trials. Here's my wife, Rondia, enjoying Yerba Santa on the Potrero John Trail outside of Ojai. And Jan Timbrook, in the book Chumash Ethnobotany that I mentioned, describes the Chumash boiling the leaves of Yerba Santa and drinking the tea for colds, chest pain, cough, and fever. They use hot baths externally to soothe foot and chest pain. Now, I mentioned boiling, and this is one of the very few leaves that is boiled to make a tea because the compounds are found in resins, which just have to be cooked for a little bit to release the compounds. Most leaves, though, you just steep in an infusion, pouring boiling water on them and then covering them and steeping them. And the famous herbalist and author Michael Moore, another of my teachers, to whom I owe a great debt, considered Yerba Santa an expectorant and bronchial dilator, meaning that it helped bring mucus up from the lungs and opened up the bronchial passages, useful in chest colds, bronchitis, asthma, and hay fever. So the resins, and if you ever handle the leaves of this particular species, you'll see how thick and sticky they get into the summer. These resins contain a powerful array of flavonoids. I mentioned Ariadictiol and Homo Ariadictiol that have shown expectorant, antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, and anti-carcinogenic activity. And a recent 2020 study cited in my book identified Ariadictiol as a top candidate for developing a drug to prevent infection by the COVID-19 virus. And in addition to all that, Yerba Santa is popular with a variety of pollinator insects, including wild bees and butterflies like this swallowtail that I saw in Metillaha Canyon in Ojai. It's a member of the borage family, known to be prolific fire followers. So here's a look at a first year plant I saw the year after the 2017 Thomas fire. You can't walk far in the chaparral after any wildfire without seeing Yerba Santa sprouting. So before I wrap it up, I am indebted to botanist Steve Junak and information resource steward Randy Wright, both of the Santa Barbara Botanic Gardens, for many of the photos in the book. And there's a long list of other great photographers without whom the book would not be what it is. And our Trail Talks host, James Wapatich, provided this exceptional photo of an island fox feasting on toyon berries. So please visit my website at herbwalks.com, where you can order the book, join my mailing list, and see my schedule of coming events, all of which are outdoors and COVID safe as much as humanly possible. Locally, on President's Day, Monday, February 21st, I'll be leading an herb walk on the San Antonio Creek Trail out of Tucker's Grove in Goleta. And then looking further ahead, I'll be doing a lunch and learn talk on Wednesday, March 16th for the Land Trust for Santa Barbara County, followed by an herb walk a few weeks later on one of their local preserves. And if you're interested in having a copy for yourself, I do ask that you please go to my website, herbwalks.com, to buy it directly from me. In the age of Amazon, buying direct from an author is the only way they can make more than a few cents per sale, as sad as that may sound. So thanks for your attention, and we'll now address your questions. Ahmad?
I'm here. That was a wonderful presentation, Lanny.
Thank you.
Just craving a salad now is what I'm craving. Okay. So we have a couple, there's questions pouring in now, so it's great. Let's kick it off with this first one here. I spend a lot of time hiking in the Sierra. Does your book overlap with plants that might appear at those higher altitudes?
Great question. When I was first asked to write this book by Falcon Guides, I immediately suggested that they have two books for California, at least, because California is a huge state geographically with so much diversity of habitats and, you know, coinciding with that, a great diversity of plants. I mean, you have plants that grow by the beach and the sand dunes in Southern California, all the way up to plants at 10,000 feet in the Sierras. But they wanted one book. So I did my best to cover the entire state. So yes, you will find plants from Northwest California, Northeast California, Southwest and Southeast California, and everything in between.
Thank you for that. There was a question here, and forgive me for mispronouncing every other word in the next 10 minutes. So, no, I noticed that there were avocado seeds in the lineament of Artemisia californica. What do the avocado seeds, what do the avocado seeds do for the lineament?
Yeah, good question. That's simply a natural way to add just a little oil to the lineament, so that it stays on the skin long enough to penetrate. If it was just pure alcohol, it would evaporate pretty quick. So that's simply what that's doing. So I always use organic avocado pits when I make my liniment.
Okay, great. A quick question on this one, may not be a quick answer, but how did the Chumash come to understand the medicinal properties of some of these plants?
Boy, that is such an interesting question, and I don't know if anyone really has the answer. because I personally have had a couple of dreams in which I was given information about plants, I have to believe that the Chumash and other, you know, traditional cultures who lived immersed in the environment and living a natural life for thousands of years probably had information come to them that way as well. But I think it's easy to assume that there was a long system of trial and error, which is what we call the empirical evidence, a long history of use. And it stands to reason that if a plant really didn't work, then it wouldn't have been passed down through the oral tradition. So I think that's a pretty good indicator. If they're still being used up to modern times after thousands of years of use, that's a pretty good validation.
Okay, rolling along here. How easy is it to grow salvia from seed, and are we allowed to collect seeds in the back country?
salvia can be grown from seed, although I haven't had the greatest success with it, but I know people who have. As far as collecting seeds in the backcountry, I did refer to California Penal Code Sections 384A and 384B. 384A specifically prohibits collecting parts of plants, such as branches and foliage, on public land. 384B was added specifically to target toyon, the berries of which I showed in James' photo of the fox eating the berries, because the foliage is green and glossy and spiny, and it has red berries. So the settlers were reminded of holly, and they started cutting it like crazy for Christmas wreaths and other Christmas decorations. So the state of California had to pass the second law prohibiting the harvesting of toyon specifically. And then they added some other plants, but they don't, they have an exemption for the parts of the plants that naturally fall out of the plant onto the ground anyway, which is the fruits and the seeds. So yes, given that, you know, you're leaving plenty of seed for the natural propagation process, to my knowledge, it is okay to harvest seeds and berries and fruits from plants.
Great. Thanks, Lenny, for that one. Tons of questions. For these, yeah, they're great. For these native plants, are some leaves or flowers better harvested in different seasons?
Absolutely. every one of these plants has its specific time of year, depending on the part that you're looking for. So for example, as far as edibles go, if you're looking for a fresh salad out of the wild, right now is the time you're going to have to go get it. You know, from whenever it starts to rain, which in this case was October, but then we didn't get a whole lot in November, if any. But whenever it starts to rain, that's really the beginning of spring in our Mediterranean climate, because we only have two seasons. We have the wet season and the dry season. So the wet season starts when it rains, and we could call that spring. And then we have this long summer that can go on for up to 8 months with virtually no rain at all. So if you want a salad, you've got to go out in the rainy season. And then each plant has its time that it's flowering, that its leaves are at the time when they're richest in these different compounds. So I tried to go into as much of those details as possible in the book, specifying when to collect the plants. Excellent question so far. I love them.
Yeah, you're going to love this question. Next one is great too. What is the fitness level needed to attend one of your walks?
All right. Well, I title my walks either herb walks or nature hikes to distinguish between the herb walks, which are generally less than a mile, and they're done on level ground with, you know, no real physical challenges. So anybody in decent physical shape can go on one of those. Then the nature hikes could be up to 5 miles, but more typically about 3 to 4 miles. So there's more walking and less talking. There might be hills to climb, there might be creeks to cross. So I go into all that and decide, you know, how to label the different events. So you can tell from my website what to expect from the title. And then I will also explain in the description what to expect as far as the difficulty.
Perfect. And that was on the website herbwalks.com for everybody.
Yes.
Just to throw it out there. And there's perfect. That's where you'll find this information. A few questions have asked if there's anywhere locally that they can purchase your book in town or in between here, I would assume, and in Ojai possibly.
Oh yeah. Well, you can definitely buy it, let's see, in Ojai at Bart's Books, at Rainbow Bridge, which is the local natural food store. I'm told by the publisher that Barnes & Noble has it, and you have Barnes & Noble in Santa Barbara, and we have one in Ventura, don't you?
I don't know. I don't get out very much.
Okay. I think there is a Barnes & Noble in Santa Barbara.
I'm in the library all day.
Yeah. Well, hopefully you'll be able to find it in the library. Hint, hint.
Okay. Yeah, soon.
and then I know Chaucer's is supposedly going to be carrying it. I have to reach out to some of these places, but the publisher assures me that most of the bookstores are on their regular list of contacts and they expect them to be ordering them. So, yeah.
Back into the book now here question. Mm-hmm. Does your book also have information on poisonous plants of California?
Some of these plants are poisonous, the ones in the book. For example, Sacred Datura is one of the plants in the book, which should only be used topically. It's a very effective pain reliever when used as a hand soak or a foot soak or heating and, you know, steaming the leaves and applying them directly to pain and swellings, but should never be ingested because it's highly poisonous. Then as far as plants that are just strictly poisonous that have no other benefits, I don't really get into those. Plants like poison oak, not included in my book. I hope that answered the question.
No, that is. And then I got some chats came in that the Barnes & Noble left about 10 years ago. The closest one is in Ventura. So,
okay.
All right. You know, Chaucer's.
So don't go looking for that.
Don't go looking for Barnes in town. Yeah. A question.
Did you see some of the early questions? I see there's a Q&A panel.
That's where I was going to there next.
I went
to the chat first.
Great.
Yeah.
Great.
Which one would you want to tackle out of that?
Any of them.
Okay.
Well, we already tackled the avocado pits.
Yes, we did. And the last one we tackled as well. So let's go. If you have time, I would like to hear something about mushroom and fungi identification and uses.
Yeah, well, I know a few edible mushrooms and I'm learning more about the medicinal properties of mushrooms, but that is really a specialty that I do not claim to be my specialty. However, I have a colleague, Jess Starwood, who just published a book in 2021 called Mushroom Wanderland. A second here, here we go.
Good title.
Mushroom, let's see, how do I get it where you can see it? Not working.
Yeah, it's gonna be a little tricky there.
Kind of going in and, because I've got this, You can kind of get glimpses of it. It's a beautiful book. She's an excellent photographer, as well as forager and mushroom expert. I also have it on my website, and you can buy it in the usual places. It's really part coffee table book and part field guide. It's so beautiful, and it's hardback. Jess and I have had scheduled a workshop for this Saturday, and we had so many people signed up, we scheduled a second one in February, and that sold out. And then we scheduled a third one also this weekend on Sunday, and we still have a waiting list of about 30 people. So I wish I could invite everyone to join one of those, but that's all the time she had on her schedule, because mushroom ID is something that really has to happen during the rainy season. We're not typically a great mushroom area. So Jess has a website, jessstarwood.com. You can go see what other events she has going on and learn from an expert. I see Peter asked about the bowl full of blues. Well, another hat that I wear, I'd have to go run and get my bowl full of blues hat, so I won't do that right now. But I was a co-producer of the bowl full of blues in Ojai, which had a 25-year run. But unfortunately, between the pandemic and a number of other factors, I don't foresee it happening again unless somebody else steps up and the pandemic loosens up. So sadly, I have no good news on that front.
Okay. there's that one on the woolly blue curls. Do woolly blue curls have medicinal properties?
Yes. I included woolly blue curls in the book, as a matter of fact, but I had that one photo of it that that Steve Junak provided of the beautiful flowers of woolly blue curls. And you can see the flowers are fuzzy, which gives them the woolly name. And they're curling and they have blue in amongst the pink. So they're really spectacular. So this is a plant that is used primarily externally as a pain liniment, and also is taken internally as a stomach tea, like you might use chamomile tea. It's anti-inflammatory for the stomach, or the digestive tract, I should say, and pain relieving as well.
Okay,
and it's in the book.
I will see here. Maybe I give another minute or two for any final questions. I think we've gone through those good little rush of questions that we received here.
Yeah, and look, we brought it in on time too.
Yeah, Mr. Carver said that the herb walk on February 21st would take place in Tucker's Grove in Goleta. Mm-hmm. The website states that it isn't Taft, is at Taft Gardens.
Okay, not the one on February 21st. No, I'm pretty certain that's it. It's the President's Day, Monday, February 21st. That's in Santa Barbara, unless I goofed up on something on the website. The Taft Gardens Natural History Walk is February 19th, I think, the Saturday of that weekend. And then I'm also doing at Taft Gardens, which is absolutely amazing place. If you haven't been there, it's a a secret gem of this area, a world-class botanical garden, which has a couple hundred acre nature preserve surrounding the main garden, which is South African and Australian plants. I'll be doing a March 20th spring equinox herb hike at Taft Gardens on Sunday, March 20th.
Let's see. Do you have a favorite tea?
One of my favorite teas is hummingbird sage. And I learned a recipe for it from Adams and Garcia. It's sort of a Chumash and Mexican recipe. So hummingbird sage is, I already mentioned the three sages of the coastal sage scrub, black sage, purple sage, and white sage. And then I mentioned chia sage, which grows on the really hot south-facing slopes in the chaparral. That's four. And the fifth one is hummingbird sage, which is the only one that grows in the shade in the canopy of the live oaks. And it has just this indescribable, wonderful fragrance. It doesn't really smell like a sage. I just can't tell you, I can't describe what it smells like, but it's just wonderful. And Cecilia has this recipe for an anti-anxiety tea of making Ibarra chocolate, which is the hexagonal red and yellow striped box of chocolate squares. So you break off one of those and you make a tea with it with water instead of milk. And then you steep the hummingbird sage leaves in that tea. And the combination is just amazing. And sure, calms my anxiety. Maybe just drinking a cup of hot tea would do that anyway, but it's I think it's a wonderful, wonderful combination.
Oh, that does sound pretty good, especially right around now. I gotta go find the stuff. Let's see. Oh, I guess we could do this. Final question is asking, mm-hmm. Where is the Taft Gardens?
Okay, the Taft Gardens is near Lake Casitas. So if you're coming from Santa Barbara, the driveway is like 9/10 of a mile from the entrance to Lake Casitas. But let me warn you, don't try to find it with a map or GPS or anything like that, because you will definitely end up on some private driveway 2 miles up into the foothills, nowhere near it. So what you have to do is register with the Taft Gardens, and you just go to I can't remember the name of the website right now, but I think it's taftgardens.org, maybe something like that. It's easy to find. And register to do a self-guided tour of the property, which they offer almost every day, or attend one of the various events going on there. And then they will send you an email when you register with specific directions. And that's the only way I recommend you try to get there, is follow those directions. You'll be glad you did.
Great. Do you have time for one more, Lanny?
Sure.
I keep saying final and final and final. They keep asking and asking and asking. No. is scrub oak different from live oak?
Yes. Okay. Well, yes. Okay. That being said, they are different species. Live oak is Quercus agrifolia. That is the large oak tree that is the dominant oak of Southern California. That's most of the oak trees you see in town or up in our canyons is coast live oak. Scrub oak is Quercus dumosa. It's as the name implies, it's a shrubby oak. It doesn't get very tall. In fact, you'll see a lot of them together making like a hedge in the backcountry. But it is also a live oak in the sense that the name live oak refers to the fact that the live oaks are evergreen. They don't drop their leaves in the winter like valley oaks and white oaks. So in that sense, it's a live oak because it's also an evergreen. So we have those two evergreens around here, and then we have the valley oak, which are the really big, beautiful oak trees that have the lobed leaves that you might be familiar with if you've seen an oak tree back east. and they drop those leaves in the winter, and they have really big acorns.
Perfect.
So yeah, I recommend coming on an herb walk. You know, we cover all different areas from the beach to Pine Mountain.
In the
pine forest, and see all the different habitats and learn about the kinds of plants you're likely to find there. There's no substitute for that. I mean, I think my book, I tried to be as thorough as I could, but no book is a substitute for going out with someone who knows what they're looking at and seeing the plants in their environment, smelling the plants, touching the plants, you know, feeling the oils, feeling the roughness, seeing the spines on the leaves, getting these clues for making a future identification. All right.
Well, ideas.
I had a great time. I hope everyone else did too. There's still 72 people here. So
you have such a calming voice to you. I mean, I'm loving this. And it's herbwalks, that's herbwalks.com. Do you find the latest information of some of these upcoming walks? I did put it in the chat here for everyone to see. Lenny, you're getting a lot of thank yous in the chat here, which is great. It's very appreciated. Thank you for your wonderful presentation and your time. We, like I said, we have this presentation recorded and hopefully up on the YouTube page in a couple days.
And thank you, Ahmad, for all your help in coaching me through the technical side of it. As I told you, which I can share now, I had a complete disaster with my first talk that I did for another organization. So Ahmad really worked closely with me, and I feel much better about this one.
This you brought your expertise and you know, we're very happy to have you. And thank you for your time, Lenny. It was such a wonderful presentation. There it is once again, Herb Walks. And if you get a chance to pick up the book, Medicinal Herbs of California, A Field Guide to Common Healing Plants, that's Falcon Guides 2021. All right. And perfect, Lenny. Thank you. And then just another quick, we're here, just the next Trail Talks again. That's going to be Thursday, February 17th. And that one's titled Los Padres Forest Association's Backcountry Trails Update. And that's with Brian Conant. Please check out the library's website. That's what it will be to register. And thank you all. And thanks for everyone spreading that love in the chat for us and for Lanny as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Bye for now.
Bye. Have a good rest of your day, everybody. Be safe.
Happy trails.